summertime, lads. This is it, isn't it? This is the life. Look at the tans on you. It's amazing.
Well, it might be summer where Phil is, but it's pissing down here.
Yeah, similar here too. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, it'll get here.
Sun always shines on you though, Phil, doesn't it?
When it's on TV.
Physically. Yeah.
Well, here we are, Series 2, Episode 10. What a very exciting evening we've got ahead. And we've got, I think, probably our biggest selection of music on a show ever. So we've actually got 13 tracks lined up for tonight, which is just phenomenal. Martin, you did an amazing job pulling all this together again. We've also got a very exciting interview. I'm going to give it away early on this one. We've got Dominic Halkin, we're going to be doing an interview with about halfway through the show, who is a songwriter. He's also a performer. Do a bit of Googling if you've not heard about him before we get to the interview. But Dominic really knows his stuff, and we're going to play an amazing piece of music that he created a little bit later on as well. To start the night off, crikey, have we got a song for you. This is unbelievable. So do you want to just give us a little bit of background on it, Martin, before we kick into this?
Again, it's a local lad called Jay Robinson. I think he's in Old Colwyn.
Right.
Local to us anyway. So... I actually met him before lockdown, I think it was. He bought one of my keyboards.
Right.
I had no idea what his involvement was. And obviously, I knew he was a musician. He works with Deadmau5. So that's a pretty big, you know, thumbs up there. Yeah, I've been asking him for a few weeks now, can we have a track? And he sent me a few. Anyway, this one is pretty special as well, because he managed to get hold of some samples for a track. I don't think it was actually planned for his track from what he was describing to me, but he's used these samples. Idris Elba,
right?
The well-known,
internationally famous actor. Yeah.
Oh yeah, just a bit. Yeah.
Yeah. So, DJ and everything else that he does.
So this is a fantastic track, and you can tell it's top-notch production.
Yeah, so, absolutely. It is amazing. Yeah, and then I know, Phil, you've been doing a lot of note-taking on this. So do you want to just give us your little quick snippet before we jump in, and we'll have your proper bits afterwards?
Yeah, I could feel a bit of the pump up the volume roots of this.
Yeah.
There's a bit of like that old schooly sort of rhythm that it starts off with. But yeah, let's have a listen to it, and I've got some other ideas after.
Brilliant, let's stick it on. So this is Jay Robinson featuring Idris Elba. This is Know Yourself.
Watch yourself. Yo.
you need to do is know yourself.
Jay Robertson featuring Idris Elba. Tune! What a tune that was to kick off with. Come on, Phil, I know you've been sitting there desperate to give your little pieces out about this one, but that was just awesome.
Yeah, like I said, I thought it started off a bit like Pump Up the Volume, and then later on it gets a bit of a swing into it, like a UK garage type of feel. But there's fantastic sample of Idris.
Yeah.
You could tell that he's got that from somewhere that had it done bespoke. Because I don't think he was done primarily for his track, but I think somebody let him have the sample with full blessings from Idris.
Yeah.
So, big thumbs up.
That's right. Apparently, I think it was originally a plan for he's worked with a guy called Majestic, who's done a rework of Boney M. Rasputin.
Oh, really?
That's sort of the connection. Yeah.
Right, but it was that was a proper big dance tune. That's a real proper get down and boogie one. I could sit and Phil, you can't help yourself sometimes. You were getting up in the middle of that one again.
Yeah, that's true. And I've got an interesting fact about Boney M. Right. One, their tour manager used to be our tour manager when we was in the Adventure Babies.
Really?
Right, yeah. And he told us they were originally called Boney Mofo because they couldn't... because you couldn't get a hit with that in those days in the 70s, they cut it down to Boney M.
Well, and do you know what? I went to the Boney M relaunch party it was somewhere in London, Covent Garden or somewhere like that, because I knew their manager at the time when they were relaunching. And there was about eight of us there. It was a sad do. It wasn't quite the relaunch they were expecting, I don't think. That was an amazing tune though. Thank you very much, Jay, for sending that in. So if people want to listen to more of Jay's stuff, where can they listen to that?
Bandcamp. Right. I think it's officialjrobinson.bandcamp.com.
Okay, brilliant, superb. Again, same as last week, we're going to have to keep this a little bit snappy tonight just because we've got so much in here and we do have an interview halfway through as well. So we're just going to have to do really quick reviews and then dip into the song. So we're going to go straight into our next one, which is, this is lovely. So this is All India Radio, Sunburst.
Thank you. not about money. It's truly about making the difference in the life of another human.
Only Human Radio.
So that was all India Radio, Sunburst. See what happy people that's made us. That was just a beautiful piece of music. It's like a real, like a proper summer vibe to it, though, wasn't it? Like a summer's evening. And it's not perfect for tonight, being so hot.
The whole album is just so chilled. The guitars in there, which are, you know, it's just so lush. And obviously, you know, there's plenty of electronics going on there. But the down-tempo, but they described as a down-tempo lo-fi instrumental group. Right. There are a few vocals as well within the actual album, but they have done so much. These guys are well, it's basically the project of Martin Kennedy, I think his name is.
Right.
And there are at least 26 albums.
Really?
So this is just one. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jeepers, it is amazing. Now, how did you find it, Phil?
Yeah, it's are these Australian guys in the origin? That touches the reach of Only Human Radio now, but it's absolutely beautiful. It's called Sunburst, and it did bring to me they always say the light is amazing in Australia, and I could imagine myself with those lush, like you say, guitars with all the delay and everything, the treatments and all that going on. I can imagine sitting in front of Ayers Rock at sort of sundown with all the colours changing and that track going on in the background.
It's not called Ayers Rock anymore, is it?
Oh, no, it's the Aboriginal name, isn't it?
Yeah.
Which I've no idea what it is.
I've forgotten now, but we'll find out later.
And with a packet of Sunburst in your pocket, because I used to love a packet of Sunburst. Remember Sunburst?
Yeah.
The little fruity thingies.
That's right.
And the lime one was really, really limey.
Yeah. Not so good if you sat on for a long time in hot weather.
No, that's true, Phil. Yeah. No, that can cause a trouser incident. Yeah. You're absolutely right there.
There's definitely a Pink Floyd-y vibe about it, I think, as well.
I've got that written down. Yeah. Pink Floyd. Yeah. Yeah. You're right.
Absolutely.
And System 7. There was an old band called System 7 in the 90s that were a bit Floyd-y and but a bit more on the electronic side. It was a bit like them, the original System 7 album.
Again, an amazing piece of music. So again, is Bandcamp best place again for searching this out?
Yeah, I think they've got... I'm pretty sure this is a Bandcamp. It's shop.allindiaradioband.com/music. And because when I go to Bandcamp, that's what comes up. So they have their own URL for some reason.
Right. Okay. So, all right. Well, we'll try and stick that link a little bit further down in the chat as well. We'll do it and then we'll forget. But that was brilliant. Thank you very much indeed for sending that through. So next up, we've got a proper friend of the show, because it's Marianne Holland, who's actually Martin's partner. I tell you what, let's go straight into this. This is Marianne Holland with Stronger.
Through so much together, it's sometimes hard to believe we've ever survived. And you never even doubted, even when I often faltered. You built a stronger steel, even when I stumble. I know we're stronger. Never believe we survived. You're very impressive when you're standing up to it all. Always so faithful, even with life's many pressures. And we will never be strangers. Never be strangers.
Marianne Holland, Stronger. Do you know what, Martin? She's got an amazing voice. I wrote down Kate Bush stroke Toya.
You said that was a QI, that was a QI thing. You shouldn't say that. The Kate Bush, she always gets compared with Kate Bush. She says, I don't sound anything like Kate Bush.
She does. She does. What did you think? Well, because Phil, you did a big yeah there. I think you probably...
Yeah, I wrote down Kate Bush, but no, I agree with Martin. She doesn't sound exactly, but she's got a Kate Bush delivery.
Yeah.
It's the delivery that's Kate Bush's rather than the tone.
Yeah. You're forgiven, yeah. Phil, but Jules isn't.
I live with it. Yeah, right. But no, it really was beautiful. She has got an amazing voice, Martin, doesn't she? She really has.
Yeah, she wrote this track probably about 20 years ago, but she used a product called Music 2000. You guys, do you know that?
No,
it's this Music 2000 software was available inside PlayStation, and so basically you got a whole bunch of samples and you just place them. It's very much like Magix when I first started using Magix, they had all these samples, all these different genres, and she put them all together to make a track. So, but also there was an element of creating riffs inside. So it wasn't just blocks of samples here and there to create a beat or whatever. She wrote it in this particular Music 2000, and then she redeveloped it, I think, in 2013, using Reason.
Oh, right.
And, and those plugins for that. And I think she used Analog Labs as well, when the old version of Analog Labs.
Yeah.
So that's how it sort of came about. I think Cubase was used as well, apparently. But so Cubase and probably Kate Walker eventually.
Yeah.
And so that's how it developed.
Yeah. But it was you can see again all the production stuff from anything you guys put out is always extremely good. How did you find it, Phil?
Yeah. I'll put in there. I guess it's coming from the old software or whatever that. I really like the vintage sounding drum machine. Sounded like a Bentley Rhythm Ace or something, or an old Roland type drum machine. I really like that.
I missed that bit because she said it was a sample again from that program of the CR78.
Right. Yes. Ah, that makes sense then. And also, she's great with I love the backing vocal treatments that stand them out. From her, because she's obviously done her own backing vocals. Sometimes that's difficult to make work, and she's managed to do it with however she's treated the voice to make those backing vocals complement her lead voice beautifully. I mean, her singing's fabulous anyway, so fits in perfectly with the tune.
Well, at the end, there's a really beautiful arp. And it's because apparently she said it was meant to be two songs originally, and that arp would often drifted into another song. But she, the way she's done it is actually finishes the song,
right?
And I recognize that. And there's a group called the Crystal Method, which I like back 10 years ago, and there's an arp very similar to it, and they're going to which is part of one of those tracks.
Yeah, again, really lovely stuff. And so Marianne's stuff, again, is Bandcamp, should we just say Bandcamp after every single one? Because probably Bandcamp's best place to go for everything, isn't it?
Yeah, she's marianneholland.bandcamp.com, but this track isn't available yet. So I think she wants to try and get it done on her next release.
Right, brilliant. Fantastic. Well, brilliant. Thank you very much, Marianne. It was just a superb piece of music. Right, we're going to jump straight into the next one. So coming up now, we have got... It's an old favourite of mine. It's Minimums. Can you lift me up? I'm really sorry. It has to go in.
I didn't even need to encourage you, did I, for you to do the joke?
Oh dear. So this is Minimums. This is Small Hours. Thank you. That was Minimum Small Hours. That was great. I mean, we've played a fair few Minimum songs before. They are always fantastic. There was a bit of keyboard in there that sounded like a trumpet sample played on a keyboard, if you know what I mean.
It's a very short piece of music. I just listened to it as a piece as a whole. I couldn't because it was just so chilled.
Yeah, I thought it was fantastic. There's some like reverse sample in there.
Yeah,
of something in backwards samples and
That was nice.
And it's called Small Hours, and it conjured up being in the Hacienda or something in the chill out room late at night. And I can imagine that track being on and just, you know, chilling out to it. You've had a bit too much to drink and just letting it wash over you and it reviving you. But what I did like, I had a look at his Bandcamp.
Yeah.
And Only Human Radio's got a bit of a mention there on his banner and that.
Oh, really?
Fair play to him.
We'll jump out of that and we're going to jump into something which is a little less relaxed, a little less ambient, but I tell you what, it's right up my alley. So we'll have a chat about this on the way out. I'll see if I can pronounce this correctly. Eromnim. That's it. Eromnim 3.
Eromnim 3, I think.
Eromnim 3. That's the fella. Dark Machina. Here we go.
I'm going to tell you about quantum computers now, but keep in mind that what we have in our pockets and our decks is a fantastic feat of technology.
Was a Romnim 3 Dark Machina. That was absolutely bang up my alley. That was just amazing. There was a voice sample in there. What was that voice sample? I couldn't work out whether that was them or whether that was a sampled piece out of a film or what it was.
I think it sounds like an interview with some sort of scientist. I think there's two samples in there. The piece is called DM6 Quantum Computing Parallel Universe. It's from the album Dark Machina, I believe.
Right.
So they, from what I was gathering from John, who's my contact, they started creating this album Dark Machina, and so every track was called DM1, DM2, etc., etc., and with a certain, you know, with some subcontext between it. Yeah, I actually heard these guys. One of my tracks was getting played on a show called from a guy I know called Chris Wave. Hmm. And it was listening to the show, and these guys popped up, and so I contacted them, and they're from Scotland somewhere. I can't remember where exactly. I should have remembered.
All right, brilliant. How did you find it, Phil?
Yeah, I thought it was powered by Iron Brew a bit, by the sound of it. It's like aggressive, sinister electronic with synthetic beats. There's a lot of thought and effort put into the breaks in those beats, I thought. Because a lot of times people just let people think beats run, but these have got like, you've got a run feeling, but it was a lot more work had gone into it. I thought it was very interesting, the vocal sample once again.
Yeah.
And it ended up really sci-fi horror-ish at the end. Felt at the end. And I really liked that. Very. And apparently they specialize on their website creating unique sonic soundscapes, which I think
describes that perfectly. I mean, that does describe it perfectly. It was beautifully dark. I did enjoy the darkness of that. I like a bit of dark.
Yeah, absolutely. I did as well.
Industrial feel, probably throbbing gristle sort of territory.
I'd say so. So again, is Bandcamp the best place to go? We skip past that throbbing gristle quickly. Is Bandcamp the best place to go?
It's a band.
I could have spun myself off very quickly on
Sorry,
managed to hold myself back. So anyway, sorry. But is Bandcamp the best place to go and find some more?
Well, funnily enough, yes.
There we go.
Eromnim3.bandcamp.com.
Perfect. Well, search them out, because if there's any more like that up there, then that's going to be an absolute treat. Right, coming up now, thank you very much indeed as well, Eromnim3. So coming up now, we've got our interview with Dominic Howcombe. So Dominic is a songwriter. He's written a best-selling single, or co-written a best-selling single that was in the charts in the UK, in Ireland, I can't remember where else in the continent, all over the place. He's also collaborated with some amazing people through the years to create some astonishing music, which we'll all have heard of. So we'll dive into the interview, and then what we're going to do on the other side of that, Dominic's very kindly given us a video of a live performance he did as well, which is absolutely just awesome. So we're going to play that on the other side of that, and then we'll come back and have a chat. So this is Dominic Howcombe. Okay, well, good evening, and we've got 2 times Ava Novello Award nominated keyboard player, session musician, songwriter, and plug-in inventor. It's only Dominic Hawken.
Oh my God, who is this guy? It's certainly not me. Thank you very much. What a welcome. I recognise that guy. All a very long time ago, I might add, so it makes it fine.
Well, not necessarily some of the plug-in inventing. That's right here and now, isn't it? We'll come on to that a little bit later on. But it's great to meet you, and fantastic that you've come on the show, and really appreciate you spending your time with us.
No, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I know Andy Darrant, as we've worked together a few times in the past. So I can't remember what happened. I think basically something he was doing popped up on my Facebook stream, and I thought, and listened to, oh gosh, must have been 6 or 7 months ago now. I listened to one of the streams. Oh, this is great. And so it's lovely to be here, actually. Really, really good. Thank you very much indeed.
No, it's a pleasure. No, thanks, and thank you for listening. So, yeah, I mean, you've had quite a career and still going on now. It's quite extraordinary what you've done. So what I was going to just chat about a little bit is right at the start of your career and how you started out. Because you started, well, you were a session musician initially, I think, weren't you? And then started to do some work with some big names quite quickly.
Kind of, yeah. I moved to Bristol with my family. And I'd learned piano at school, but I just got to the stage where I kind of got to grade 8, and I was good. I enjoyed piano, but
yeah,
I couldn't really play anything other than sheet music. And I got to that stage where it was getting a bit boring. I wasn't going to be a pianist. I quite liked, you know, I was well into music, and I quite liked tech and that kind of stuff. And synthesizers had just kind of come out that were almost affordable.
Yeah.
So rather than being the Jupiter 8s at £2,000 or £3,000, the Juno 6 had come out, and the stuff that everyone loves these days, yeah, the JX31, and they were under £1,000, which was still a big ask, but you could scrape my money together and buy a synth. And I wanted to join bands, so I joined a band that I found in Bristol. And I was literally just doing, it was quite a big pub kind of music scene, and it was pre kind of Massive Attack and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So we were going out, and it was the first time I'd ever really played in a band. And I realized that piano lessons weren't really that much help when someone comes along with a guitar and says, right, play along to this, you know, blah, blah, blah. And you're like, I don't really know what I'm doing, you know. And I realized the one thing about synthesizers is that with one note held down, you sound a lot more interesting than a piano with one note held down. So you can make up for a lack of ability with enthusiasm and a good sound. So that was my kind of baptism. And whilst we were doing this and we were playing, we had loads of fun. I got a university place in London. I just went down to London for everything. And I just wanted to move to London because that's where the music was really. And I took a year off. I didn't really want to go to university. I just had no idea how. So I took my year off, and before that year kind of started, one of the guitarists in the band, in another band, the Bristol band that we knew, had a flight back from Dubai, where I think a lot of the musicians would go out to Dubai to do gigs in sort of covers bands and stuff out there. It's quite lucrative. So a lot of the guys that were working in Dubai in the, in the hotels and stuff that they were staying, they used to put on entertainment. He came back anyway. And he said, I've just come back from Dubai, and I sat next to Marilyn, this guy who was a pop star in the 80s. His friend, he said, I had Marilyn's flatmate, who was also over there singing, a guy called Eddie. And he's looking for a guitarist and a keyboard player. And I said, I might do guitar for him. Can you, yeah, do you fancy doing the keyboard? I said, this is great. This is really great. So so we went off to London with my keyboard and in my Ford Escort and him in his, with his guitar. And it turned out that this is a guy called Eddie Armani, who's a great singer, but never quite cracked it. And he was doing a gig supporting Marilyn, his flatmate, right, relaunching Marilyn's career. And it, I'll cut a long story short, I ended up playing keyboards for Marilyn and Eddie Armani. And then subsequently Boy George, after he left the Culture Club. So I kind of cracked that scene of,
yeah,
of circle of people, if you like, really. And that got me, yeah, basically Culture Club, after Marilyn basically did the gig, we did some recording with him. I was in a band briefly with a lovely lady, Kate Garner, who was in Hazy Fantasy.
Yeah.
Back then with Jeremy Healy, who's now a massive DJ. So I was in a band called Deep Space with another lady called Julia, Princess Julia, who's a massive club icon. And this was me aged 18, I think, just
that's unbelievable,
into
isn't
this
it?
Situation in London, which was just like, I mean, honestly, 2 years before that, I'd looked at pictures of Hazy Fantasy in magazines and gone, oh, I'd love to be in a band like that. Do you know what I mean? This, the pictures and the images were incredible. And now I'm sitting in their flat, you know, with Paul Kaplan, who was Hazy's manager and Marilyn's manager, going like, this is, yeah, this is great, you know, very incredibly naive. A certain amount of naivety is good because you just do stuff you'd never thought you'd be doing. You know, well, this absolutely. Is amazing.
But it's like a real sliding doors moment, that, isn't it? I mean, it's just,
yeah,
you know, it's obviously you've got to have the talent to be able to back yourself up with that. But it's just these chance things that happen sometimes, and all of a sudden that opportunity is there, and you've got to grab it.
It's massive. I'm a massive sliding doors things. I always say to people, like, one song will do it, one meeting will do it. There's a couple of two or three times, I think, maybe in my life that something's happened that you might not have picked up on it. And loads of things that happened that I haven't picked up on it. So it's, but a couple of big turning points were because I took time to speak to someone or find out what they were doing or help or go, yeah, I'll do that. Oh, it's going to, I'll give it a go, you know. And it was absolutely amazing because from after Deep Space, there was a band called Eric and the Good Good Feeling who signed to, unfortunately didn't crack anything, but signed to Warner's. And it was a brilliant band. Eric was a staff writer at Motown, wrote these amazing songs, had a real Prince kind of fabulous voice. And he was the musical director for doing the George. And so it was a natural thing to kind of move into this band, again, managed by the same team. And he was a keyboard prodigy. And I was the second keyboard player. So looking back on it, he did it on purpose. But at the time, he would come over and go, Dominic, can you play this? And I'd be like, yeah, I can play that. And the rest of the night working out this part and kind of come back the next day and say, yeah, see, I can do it, you know, oh, we'll try this. And but it kind of taught me how to play keyboards, which was just epic, you know, because sheet music versus, you know, chords, I really hadn't played, you know.
Yeah.
So it was this baptism of fire. And then we signed to Warner's. This is at the same time as Transvision Jam Band, the other ones that signed at the same time. And they stuck us in the studio with Stephen Hague, the producer Stephen Hague, who had literally just finished the New Order's True Faith.
Yeah.
Literally, he'd finished True Faith. We were the next ones in the studio. So they were mastering True Faith upstairs. And he was making the single with us, you know, and I was just there lapping it up, really, to be honest, you know, sitting, I didn't play on it, but watching this guy and this amazing engineer in Mayfair Studios making the tunes. So that was amazing. And then in the meantime, of course, at night, there's clubs like, seminal clubs like Taboo, which now they've written plays and books about Taboo. I'd be wandering there with Boy George and Marilyn on the guest list, swarming in and going, this is crazy. You know, it's just incredible characters around. And I would be the person that everyone took to me being straight. It was the funniest thing. Everywhere I'd ever been up to that point. You know, I was the oddest. Everyone would be taking the mickey, which was brilliant. Absolutely lovely. Just incredible. And I was so, I'm sitting, you know, there again, still kind of 18 with the Stephen Haig thing. And I basically was still playing live with George on some of the gigs that he was doing outside of Culture. That then hit his kind of druggy phase where it all sort of dipped. It was, he went through a real drop, which wasn't great to see. And it's great that he's come out the other side. So I was kind of keyboard playing in that, which was entertaining to a degree in itself, if not a bit of a challenge. And then after that, I really had to try and to be in the studio. So I kind of bluffed my way into production a little bit. And I was working with friends and learning studio and stuff. I mean, I had a little studio at home, so I knew my way around that. I suddenly seemed to blag my way into producing little stuff on decent studios on decent desks. And I started doing remixes, being the keyboard player. So because I had all the computer kit and I could do everything from programming the drums through to the synths and stuff, I was the one man kind of operation that would go in with DJs quite a lot, because when the massive remix boom exploded back then, and you ran and pull up both of and some other guys like that, really translating their ideas into music, you know. So with, I only did a tiny bit with Paul Oakenfold, but with Danny Mantling I did quite a lot, and sometimes that would literally be, this is what's happening, this is the feel I want on this tune, because it wasn't particularly musical, to translate what's going on in his head to something that's coming out the other end. It's quite a skill, really. Crikey. And
so you've got a craft. He's trying to explain that to you, and you're trying to craft that together to turn it
exactly, to try and work it out, you know. And the skills of those, because I've never got up, stuck a record on and watch everybody walk off the as I'm sure every DJ has done at one stage in his life. And I've never been, you know, put a record on and watch everything explode, you know. And their ability to read moods and stuff is incredible. So it's so brilliant to go into a situation where you've got a song, so you can bring in your musical ideas, and people might go, oh, DJs, you know, you can bring it, they'll never work unless you've got this kind of tastemaker who's saying, I know what's going to happen when I put this on, because I've done it before, you know, I know where it needs, such a learning experience doing
and
that
remixing
kind of stuff.
As well is an extremely difficult art form. I'm nowhere near experienced as you with making music. When I first started making music, remixing is what I wanted to do, so that's why I started off trying to do. And then I realized it's almost impossible. It's just so hard to improve on something which was already very good in the first place. Everything I did was just terrible, so I thought, well, I'll make my own stuff instead.
If it's a track you like, where'd you go? You know, it's okay if you come in and go, I think I can make this better, or I think I can take this into a style that will work in a particular thing. I mean, first remix boom got a bit crazy. It did get to the point where there'd be 10 remixes commissioned on a track, and Danny would get 10 grand a mix or something, you know, for 2 or 3 days work.
Yeah.
And then really, I think it kind of fell apart because of that, because at the end of the year, the labels would look at their yearly returns, and it turned out that they'd paid to sign the act, they paid to record the record, they paid 10 remixes to remix it, they'd had to give away the remixes to DJs because the DJs weren't going to buy them, they probably had to buy the singles to get them back in the charts anyway.
Yeah.
The original kind of move on singles was to fund the albums. You know, no one was buying the albums off the back of remixes back then. It's different now.
Yeah.
But he pulled all the funds away, and suddenly it was like, oh, what should I do now? You know, do a bit of production or something, you know. But it taught me, and I was lucky, I had some hits. I was able to make tunes in studios and see them chart, and make tunes and see them not chart, you know, see what worked. And that's an amazing experience to be able to, obviously it's a dream come true. It's super exciting to see what works. And you realize how good some A&R guys were back then, and how good and how bad some were, you know, the chances that just get lucky, and the consistent, whether they be managers or label execs or A&R or acts or whatever, that to keep that level going is just phenomenal.
Yeah.
So then I kind of just blundered around. I did a bit of songwriting and bits and pieces, and just I actually set up a company that did more.
I was just going to say, well, you're kind of downplaying what you're doing an awful lot there. So you did it because you did loads of things. You were involved with Tribe Called Quest, kind of kick it. So that's just it's an anthem. It's just an unbelievable song.
Yeah, that was one of the remixes. So as well as Danny Rampling, I worked with two guys called the Boiler House Boys, Ben and Andy, who are DJ team. They're less well known. They're probably the best DJ team that never quite cracked to be the superstar DJ.
Yeah.
But they're the DJ's DJ. And the two really, really got on well. I did loads and loads of stuff with them, from MC Hammer, who no one would ever mention, through to really obscure hip hop, where British hip hop wasn't a thing, you know. And they had an incredible knowledge of music. Again, neither of them particularly musical, but really very insightful in that here's a track, here's a remix.
Yeah.
I know what would work there. And Tribe Called Quest is a classic example of that. It was a tune that had been around for a while that everyone was just loving, saying this is going to be a hit, whatever. And Corda Marshall, who had them sign, he's still a massive guy in the industry, he wanted to do a mix for the UK release because it's a mix away from the album. If you listen to the album, it still has a Lou Reed on the intro, but it's pretty hardcore, straight hip hop. Great track.
Yeah.
But a bit different from what ended up charting. And so he gave it to us, the three of us, to mix. And it was absolutely just one of those things that just came together. But to show you some of the influences, I mean, on the challenge on hip hop, and we were doing a lot of it, was you couldn't play anything, everything had to be sampled. So you literally couldn't play a chord.
Yeah.
So back then it was a case of if you take a sample off a piece of vinyl, it would be at the wrong starters. So you're time stretching things in S1000s and S1100s, which just has a percentage that you can stretch to. There's no garage band or Ableton Live draggy. Mm. Oh, that's it, you know, automatic. So a lot of my job would be the technicalities of how do I make this technically fit, you know, which is a great challenge. So I used to love it. Not only was it hip hop, which I love, it was like, how on earth am I going to make this work, you know, with these dials and stuff. But there is Archie Bell and the Drells. There's Ian Dury and the Blockheads. What a Waste is a sample on there. We've got a sample of John Pert, the Scarecrow, in that thing.
Oh, really?
That he did. there's so much stuff. Just really, really cleverly. I mean, technically cleverly, but actually musically linked together that you'd never believe was going on. Actually, we've got Prokofiev in there. We were sitting there on the stage thinking, oh, I've got to get Prokofiev in a hip hop track. And he's in there, you know, it's the intro to The Apprentice, the dum, 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 that classical intro.
Yeah.
That's in there. And we had to do it twice because we did a whole brilliant version with a Sound of Muse start with the lady from the Sound of Music going, the first three notes are, and the whole track would start. And then we spun her in as samples all the way through.
Yeah.
And then when they went to put it out, they couldn't get clearance for using those samples. So we literally had to go in, and this took us 3 days or something to make this thing, which is a long time in remix world. You normally get a day and you end up leaving at 6 a.m. So we literally had to go back in and remake it completely. And we found a Beatles record where on the B side, there was an announcer going, oh, this is the sound of now, it's crazy. And and screaming fans and stuff. So added loads of other stuff all over it. But we got Pete Tong in. He's in there going, A Tribe Called Quest. You know, so he turned up. We gave him dinner to say that. You know, it's an amazing tune. And that's one of the ones that was a hit. So, you know, kind of a month later, we were in remixing, I think, the Mint Juleps or something. We were doing the next track because there was so much work. And the midweek charts would come through. And that was the first time we could look at the midweek charts and go, it's come in at number 20, that's not bad, you know. And so you feel like you're in the proper music industry, you know, you've done something that actually can bought, which is huge.
But but as it is a proper anthem now, that as well, you know, mention it to anybody, everybody knows that song, you know, it's one of those ones that immediately anybody who knows anything knows.
And Full Marks to Try, because you know there's a massive difference between making a tune and remix it and making it a hit, you know.
Absolutely.
The artist is without doubt the most important. They're at the tip of that pinnacle.
Yeah.
There's no control experiment to work out what would have happened if it hadn't been turned into that, but it's definitely a lot. what I like about it, it turned it into more of a crossover hit without taking any of the impact of the hip hop away. You know, it wasn't commercialized. It was a little bit and just made a little bit more interesting in some respects, because there's more going on without taking away any of the roots. And the band loved it. That's the most important thing. Because if you've got a band like Tribe, who already had a lot of, you know, kudos and albums, you don't want to be taking their tune and making it something that they go,
absolutely,
you know, with the nicest possible way. Three little guys in London who don't know much about hip hop, but they did. They loved it. So that was the proud moment.
I bet it was. I mean, yeah, it's an amazing piece of work. Dominic Hawken, it's been an utter pleasure talking to you this evening. I've really, really enjoyed myself and really appreciate you spending the time with us.
It's brilliant to be on it. As I say, I'm a big fan. So, yeah, more power to you. It's really, really good. And I hope lots of people hear it as well. It's really good.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to jump into a song now. So we're actually going to play, this is a Mr. Wiggly that you did for, I think it was Clownfest actually you did this for, wasn't it? There's actually two halves to this. We're going to play the first half this week and we're going to play the second half in the next show. And the first half is just awesome. It's The Good Doctor. Anything with him in there is just going to be amazing. And it's his Beasley Street poem, isn't it? Which you've put
That's
to
right.
music.
Yeah, yeah.
It's awesome.
It is. He's an incredible man, isn't he?
And
what can you say? And it's a bit of a mix of my love of dub and a mix of that. You just can't top him. You could play dustbins or incinerators behind him and it would still sound great. But it's a live jam with elements of Door involved for this. So Clownfest was an online festival. Clownfest 6 is coming up in August, I think. It's a really good thing. Check out Clownfest on Fed for them. So thank you very much indeed.
That's a pleasure. So we're going to play now Beasley Street, which is John Cooper Clark, which has been put together by Dominic Hawken. Thank you very much, Dom.
Smiles and a baby dies in a box on Beasley Street. collar and inspector calls where the perishing stink of squalor impregnates the walls. The rats have all got rickets. They spit through broken teeth. The name of the game. And a pink
Human Radio.
So that was Dominic Halkin. What an interesting chap he was. And what an amazing piece of music. I mean, that was a proper anthem that he was playing on there. And I hadn't realised, but it was actually you, Phil, pointed it out about the poem.
Yeah, it sounded like John Cooper Clarke poem. It's definitely a John Cooper Clarke poem. Whether it's him delivering it, I don't know. Because it's so in time with the music, it's like he did it as a performance. I don't know.
But as a piece of music, Phil, that really was something, wasn't it?
Oh, like dub going on, dub reggae, and some fabulous dub drum breaks and what have you, you know, rim shots and timbales and stuff. Fantastic. Absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, it was absolutely amazing. Thank you very much indeed for that. And Martin, how did you find that?
Yeah, well, as I said, the dub vibe was great. Reminded me a bit of the Left Field album. So that's sort of very left field.
But yeah, we're pretty sure it was. But it was amazing anyway. So thank you very much indeed, Dominic, for doing the interview and also for giving us that piece of music to play as well. It was awesome. And thanks for being a part of the community as well. He's part of our human community, which is great to have everybody involved into that. Yeah, so thank you once again. Right, so we're going to move out of that and we're going to move into a good old friend of the show, which is Etch a Sketch. So we'll pop this on and we'll have a chat on the other side. So this is Etch a Sketch, The Wait.
Thank you. Numbing medication. 1, 2, 3.
Only Human Radio.
So that was Etch-a-Sketch, The Wait. It's hard to describe sometimes the pieces of music he makes. It's Rob Dixon. But that was just a lovely, warm, rolling, ambient piece that kind of just enveloped you a little bit and sort of wrapped its arms around you, and you just had to go with the flow with the whole thing.
Yeah, I loved it. I think he's getting better and better. Old Rob, he gets through a lot of gear, but he seems to get to know it quite quickly and be able to produce some fabulous stuff. But I love that industrial start to it. It sounded like somebody doing some industrial sort of process down a tunnel, and then it was like a Viking crumb horn or something started to come in.
Yeah,
and got a totally different feel. And then it ended up in like some sort of sci-fi soundscape.
Yeah.
So I started to think, oh, you're on some sort of different planet. So I went from sort of in some sort of factory through to like ancient history to it's on another planet whole journey. Yet it all made sense. Fantastic.
And it was a journey as well, wasn't it? It was a proper journey. Was it me or did anybody else spot something which sounded like a cat purring in there? Was that just me? Or is it just my cat purring?
Didn't hear that.
Didn't you?
Could have been your listen cat again. Purring.
There was like a could have been my cat purring, you're quite right. But it was like an underlying sound. It was about halfway through, I think, that I spotted it, of like a cat purring in there. As I say, it could just be me. But have a listen again.
Do you think it was a famous cat, like Mrs. Slocum's pussy from Are You Being Served?
It could very well be. But again, you're not gonna get me going.
That cat, wasn't that cat called Throbbing Gristle?
There's always one, it's usually you.
I asked Rob, it was all modular stuff.
Right.
And again, if you guys know, I can try and pronounce it, I'm a right mess of it, but a morphogene and Akbar and a Mionfon. For all the glitchy delay stuff.
Easy for you to say, Martin.
Isn't it weird how Zoom made you all glitchy as you were talking about the glitchy gear? Amazing.
But it was, again, thanks very much, Rob. It was a beautiful piece of music. That was Etch-a-Sketch The Way. I know Rob's got a load of stuff on Bandcamp, so if you go and search up Etch-a-Sketch on Bandcamp, you'll find him on there. He's also actually got an album on Spotify at the moment as well, so you can go and find him on there too. So do search that out. Right, we're going to come out of that. I'm going to go into... This is great. Okay, we'll talk about this on the other side, but this is Caro C. This is Dreamers for Alyssa.
Thank you. The madman you and the madman you. The magma in me. The magma in you. The magma in me. The magma in you. And our magnificent capacity. Our magnificent capacity for renewal.
Dreamers for Alyssa. That was amazing. Was that the best use for cowbell ever? It was a cowbell, wasn't it?
It was beautiful. Well, some sort of beautiful mallets, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe it wasn't a cowbell then. Just me thinking. That's the best use of ever a cowbell for years, because normally you just get a dong out of it, don't you?
Yeah.
Oh, ding dong.
Exactly. Maybe it's just me. How did you find it, Phil?
Well, like you say, I didn't find it was a cowbell. I put clanky glockenspiel.
That's probably more like it.
But it was, and it's got glitchy drum pattern again with a weird timing, which we like on this show.
Yeah.
But and I love a noise snare drum as well. It got a noise snare drum in there. And then this clanky glockenspiel that you think's a cowbell came in.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, that's interesting. And do you know what? Through all the randomness, it got quite a good melody to it.
Yeah.
That you could really pick up on the melody, and that carried you through the song. And I thought it was very clever, actually. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Clever piece of music.
Because again, it's one of those pieces that's not necessarily challenging to listen to, but it's not as easy a piece just to sit and listen to as others, because there is so much other interesting things going on there. You kind of want to concentrate on it, really, rather than just sit back and let it wash over.
Yeah.
You don't want to miss out on the little nuances that are going on in there.
Now, I just wanted to mention the lyrics in there, because there was I'm wondering if Dreams for Alyssa is about a guinea pig, and I'm going to tell you this now, why. Because she mentions magma in there.
Right.
Magma. And then on our power for renewal, we used to have a guinea pig called Magma.
Are you sure that she wasn't just drinking Magnas?
Magma, not Magnus.
Oh.
You're always going to alcohol. Jules. I don't know.
Is Magma the hamster still around?
No, made me wonder about the power for renewal. Unfortunately, didn't apply to our guinea pig, Magma, who's now dead.
This track is coming from a new album called Electric Mountain.
Right.
So So I better give you a bit of background to Caro, because met her a couple of, 2-3 years ago at a performance in Birmingham. And she's sort of the electric acoustic sort of scene. And so, yeah, experimental music is, you know, probably is her forte. and she does a lot of commissions for theatre and films. And I think BBC describe her as a sonic enchantress, which is probably a great description.
Yeah.
But say I met her, and the other sort of big thing how I've made a connection was obviously seeing her perform, is that we both have a love for Delia Derbyshire,
right?
And she's one of the ladies involved with the Delia Derbyshire Day,
right?
And so every year, well, apart from what's just happened, there is an event in Manchester where they have a Delia Derbyshire Day.
Right.
And they get lots of musicians together to do electroacoustic type of music. And she's, I think she's one of the main organisers.
Oh, superb. Yeah, well, it's, really? I have seen a bit of stuff online about the Delia Derbyshire Day. That's worth looking up. And if you don't know about Delia Derbyshire, it's worth doing a bit of a Google on her as well, who's quite an amazing pioneer. Yeah. Absolutely. That was an amazing piece of music again. So thank you very much indeed for that. We've got now something coming up, which is lovely. Am I allowed to do my joke? I don't know. So stick it in anyway. Why don't you wear Russian underpants?
Because Chernobyl fallout.
Yes, that's exactly it. That's exactly it. So now we have got Black Mass with Chernobyl.
Thank you.
that was Black Mass Chernobyl. That just washed over me like something, just, I feel almost bad about doing the joke at the beginning now, because that was such an amazingly wonderful emotional piece of music.
Well, I've been sort of listening to some stuff when I first started writing music again, sort of 2008-09. I had a lot of music I was buying at the time, and so Blank Mass was I think it was actually in Q magazine of I thought, oh, I'll get this because it sounds like something I'd like.
Yeah.
So I went for a walk the other day, and I put Blank Mass on again. I thought, oh, this is amazing. And it was difficult to choose what to put on because there's so much.
Mm.
And I didn't realize actually, because one of his tracks on the album, this is from the self-titled album Blank Mass, yeah. Is one called Sundowner, right. Which was used during the opening ceremony of the 2012 Olympics, apparently.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, so that's a bit of, now I'm not sure I'm allowed to say the F word, but unfortunately,
we're not.
But,
yeah. Just to bring that.
Say, yeah.
Yeah. Well, he's a member of the Buttons.
Right. We'll beep that bit over there.
So yeah, it's Benjamin John Power. He right. Is Blank Mass.
Right. Okay. That's super. How did you find it, Phil?
Yeah, well, I thought it was lovely. Like you said, it was like a wash of sound, but so much emotion in it, which summed up to me Chernobyl. And last night I tried to listen to it, and I nodded off to it, which isn't a criticism. Yeah. It's because it was so hypnotic, and I just relaxed totally to it. And I've had a good listen today, and it's absolutely fabulous. So
my cat's agreeing as well. I don't know if you can hear it. But my cat was having a right good agree to that.
Slightly, yeah.
Oh, I thought that was my pussy.
No, not this week. Not this week, Martin. Not this week. But it's like, do you remember in the Morecambe and Wise show? There used to be a guy come on with a mic with a mouth organ, and he'd come
not
on.
Now,
and
he'd go, not now, Arthur.
Not now. Not now.
Yeah, not now, Arthur. Yeah.
I forgot about that. Used to love that. Anyway, by the by. Wow. So now we have got another friend of the show coming up, another member of the community. This is Mark Albrow. This is just a brilliant piece of music. So anyway, we'll talk about it on the other side. This is Mark Albrow. Doors Slam, Water Splashes, Children Laugh. was Mark Allbrow, Door Slam, Water Splashes, Children Laugh. What a wonderful collection of sounds just pulled together into a beautiful piece of, it's almost not a song, just an experience. It was just absolutely delightful, that whole thing. How did you find it, Phil? You've swapped places, Phil. Look at that. You've jumped into Martin's seat and Martin's jumped into you. How did you do that?
I don't know. I look the same way round on here.
That's extraordinary.
He's down the bottom for me.
It's
not,
like Celebrity
not down
Squares.
My bottom, but...
It's like Celebrity Squares with Lenny Bennett.
Gosh, yeah, weird, isn't it?
Yeah. Anyway, sorry, Phil.
Anyway, back to the. It's a curious title considering I couldn't hear much water splashing or children laughing, but I could hear plenty of found sounds going on in there.
Yeah.
And it started with a jaunty sort of swing beat and then went into this. It was another journey, wasn't it, really? It was there was like a clockworky sort of bit in there.
Well, yeah,
I found it very interesting.
Yeah, like a children's music box type thing, wasn't it? Like a wind-up music box in there.
Yes.
It just had a very childlike feel about the whole thing. It made me smile throughout because it just, you know, yeah. I was looking at the title thinking, I know exactly why you've called it that because it feels like that title. Well, I also wrote down, could have been eerie, but wasn't.
Yes, eerie. Yeah. Perhaps I tuned into the eerie.
Right, next up, we've got... okay, let's just dive straight into this. We'll chat about it on the other side. This is Eric Wallow, Different Spaces.
Thank you.
That was Eric Wallow, Different Spaces. That was like having a walk along a distant shoreline somewhere, the wind gently blowing in your hair. And you know what I mean? You're kind of getting lost in the moment, walking by something. That was just absolutely awesome. Real lovely ambient piece of music again. How did you find it, Phil?
Yeah, like you said, it's like I couldn't make out whether it was real guitar in there or it had been done on a synth with a guitar sort of sample. And there's like some Ebo guitar in there as well. You know, where you use like a magnet, I think it is, to resonate the strings and what have you. And also in the background. Now, I'm a sucker for a bit of phased rhythm, a la the middle bit of Autobahn, where you... like a fantastic bit of phased rhythm in there. I love that. And it was just... like a wash with atmosphere, had summery images. It's another one, because I'm one person that music does make me drift off to sleep if it's too relaxing. And I thought, wow, at the right time of the evening, this would be great. This would be fabulous.
Oh, but it was a really lovely piece of music. How did you find it, Martin?
Well, I said, I've been enjoying Eric Waller's music for a few years now, and it's just beautiful. And you're right, he's a guitarist. As well, obviously he's a guitarist, but obviously he likes, you know, he creates these atmospheric, beautiful electronic pieces with sequences in them. And what you were saying about the rhythm is always, like, to me, was always a little bit secondary, but it's, you know, it's there, but it's the main part of the piece is the ambience of the whole piece. There are beats in his music, which you can hear them, but they just sit there in the background. Not too intrusive.
Yeah, it's crafted, isn't it? You know, it's the something that builds the, it keeps that rhythm in there, but you don't, it isn't sort of front and center. It's just there to keep the whole thing moving along and just give you that feel that it feels, you know, just feels right. Right, we're coming up to, it's our proper friend of the show. It's Andy Peggs.
Friend of the show, mate.
It is proper friend of the show. So I'll tell you what, let's dive into this one. And then we'll have a chat about it on the other side. But this is Andy Peggs with his Snorps Showcase.
Thank you.
was Andy Peggs with his Snorps Showcase. You can find, where does he put all his Snorps? I think those are on Bandcamp as well, aren't they? Everything's on Bandcamp.
Andypeggs.bandcamp.com.
Yeah. So, that, I mean, they are just an amazing set of apps, aren't they? And he gives them away so that you can actually go and use them and stuff if you want to and all the rest of it. I am writing that, aren't I? He does, doesn't he, I think.
I think they're free to download. And, yeah. You know, it's... I didn't quite listen to the whole 73. I think it was 73. But I listened to a few and I chose from each album or Snorps collection, one to select from this group. Basically what we did, we chose five from each individual Snorps. And he's actually just released Snorps 6 today.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Prolific isn't really the word, is it? Yeah. Yeah. It's quite extraordinary. And then you stitch together the five that you'd chosen for Andy, and then we put those together. And Andy produced those videos. So if you listen on the radio, you won't be able to see the videos. But anyway, Andy produced the videos that went with those as well. So how did you find these, Phil? Obviously, you've known Andy a long time.
Oh, yeah. I've known Andy, man and boy. And I just can't get over his energy. It makes me go, makes me mad. How does he do all this stuff? I mean, while he's doing that, he's doing the allotment. He's got the kids, the cats, the job, and he does all these Snorps. He does all snippets of, and it's always really catchy tunes he manages to do. And you think, have I heard that before? And you think, no, I haven't. Yeah, it's so familiar and catchy. I particularly like the last Snorp, the Metal Feet. Yeah. Which is more than a small knob. Knob.
Hey!
More than a small nod. That slip. It's more than a small nod towards Kraftwerk and the robots.
Yeah.
It's brilliant.
Same thing there. I think it was Numbers by from Computer World. It reminded me of the last one.
Yeah. It's fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah, they really. Yeah. I mean, he does produce some cracking stuff. And as I say, go and have a listen on Bandcamp because there's loads of them on there. And if he's just released a load more as well, and they are quite inspirational little pieces, those to use if you want to use them.
The intention was always for the music to be a snapshot in a moment in time. The patches are dismantled after each recording, rendering them impossible to replicate.
Oh, right.
It's a shame, but because I said to him, some of these have got legs.
Yeah,
you know, but it said you can't replicate them again, so that that's it, what you hear.
Right.
You can't expand it into a full track.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he used one of those little Atoria keyboards. What they called the Keystep Pro. I think he uses one of them. But also, I wonder if it's worth mentioning his new venture, the electronic music open mic.
Indeed.
That he's doing along with all his Snorps, along with rebuilding a synth out of wood and all sorts of stuff that he's doing. And he's even blown Tim Lewin out the water with the amount of output. And that's saying something.
Surely not. Some of the beat Tim.
Yeah. So it's worth it. If anybody wants to fancy getting in touch with him about playing live like an open mic situation, please get in touch with him because I think he's looking for people to step up.
In Chester,
next one's
it?
In Chester, isn't it? Yeah, Chester. I can't, again, the date, I can't remember what the date is, but it's Chester.
It's late summer in Chester, I think it is, isn't it? And then I think he's actually going to tour it around a little bit so that they're going to do it in different places, which would be great as well. Thank you very much, Andy. Wonderful tunes as always. So it's the last big song of the night, lads. And it is a big song. It's a very big song. It's a very, very big song. It's Big Black Delta. This is Hugging and Kissing.
Yeah. and she told me that she loved me, and she gave me my money back.
Big number that was an absolute proper stormer to end the show on, wasn't it? That really was monster. How do you find that, Phil?
Yeah, now I've put down and I'm not meaning to make name drop or anything like that, because as you know, I used to be signed to Factory, and I just thought this would have gone so well on Factory Records roster around the late 80s, early 90s. It's just got those type of drums that sort of New Order-ish, and it's got an old school feel, but up to date sort of thing. And I think the guy who does this music is got associated with Nine Inch Nails or something. He's quite a well connected guy. So I was looking on the internet.
Right,
I don't know if I'm right, wrong, or right, Mark.
This is a side project. He's of Jonathan Bates.
Right.
His name is.
That's it. Yeah.
And his main band output is a band called Melodrone, and for the sound of it, it sounds like it's going to be another electronic, but it's more rock.
Right,
it's like a rock band than anything, a Melodrone. So, but there's two albums out now, and how I found this in sort of January, February, we're watching a lot of Netflix, and I don't know if you guys do this, but I hear something, then I have to Shazam it, and. I was watching a series called The Sinner, and it's a brilliant series. Brilliant series. And this music was part of this particular series one of The Sinner, and that's how I heard it. And since then I bought two albums of his, it's just brilliant.
Yeah, it is superb. Yeah, absolutely. Why did you find it there, Phil? Again?
Yeah, it was absolutely brilliant, and I think there's some mention of his band actually supporting Gary Numan. Have you
really?
Gary Numan.
Get out of town.
Yeah.
Well,
he used to be a friend of the show, but he fell out with us, didn't he?
Yeah, he did a little bit. Yeah. Over those fruit pastels. Yeah. Yeah. We won't bring up fruit pastel gate again. No. Well,
didn't any good you nicking his spaceship?
Shh. Not now, Arthur. Not now. That's going to be a running joke of the show now, that is. Right, well, that was a superb piece of music. Thank you very much indeed, Big Black Delta. Again, Bandcamp, probably best place, is it? Or Spotify?
BigBlackDelta.bandcamp.com.
There we go. Thought it might be. And also, we've got something very exciting happening actually this week, haven't we? So, Gonzo Magazine. We've actually got some space in Gonzo Magazine. Go on, Phil.
Yeah. It's called Gonzo Weekly, if you want to Google it. And
how often is it out, Phil?
I think it's fortnightly. You'll have something from us every fortnight, I hope.
So
it's called Gonzo Weekly.
So where do people actually find it? So if you want to go and have a look at it, where is it? Is it a physical weekly or is it a digital weekly?
I just Googled it. Right. I Googled it. I should have written the blooming URL down, but I forgot.
It's a PDF. He produces every week.
Yeah.
But very kindly, he's given us some space in there. So it is gonzoweekly.com, I think, which is fortunate. There it is. Yes, I've got it up on my screen now. Gonzoweekly.com. So if you just go there, you'll be able to find it.
It's easy then. It's easy. Yeah. It's a good, really, really interesting read.
Yeah.
It really is. Because it's not, it's a bit like Only Human Radio. It's not mainstream. It's, you know, it's got a different outlook and very interesting. And really nice chap that runs it, isn't it, Martin, his friend of yours?
Yeah, Jonathan Downs. Yeah, he's involved with The Weird Weekend, which is a collection of a very strange... generally strange things about flying saucers, creatures that don't exist.
I like the sound of that.
Brilliant. Yeah. I love that, yeah.
Yeah, that'd be cracking. That sounds like a boys' weekend away to me. That'd be superb. So, do do Google it. Go and have a look at it. We've got a little piece in there, and it is a great little read as well. It's just nice, unusual, eclectic little piece to have a read around. So thank you very much for featuring us that as well. Talking to thank yous, let's just have a quick rundown of what we've had tonight, because we've had some amazing stuff on. So we started off with Jay Robinson featuring Idris Elba, Know Yourself. What a tune that was. And it, and he's also on the Deadmau5 label. And I think you were saying he actually kind of works with Deadmau5 as well, from Old Colwyn, Round the Corner. Who would have thought that? So that was a superb piece of music. Thank you very much for that. And then we came into All India Radio. I did that exactly the same last time. All India Radio is what I'm trying to say. Sunburst, which was that beautiful summer vibe that we had there as well. Then we came straight into Marianne Holland, Stronger, which was that lovely. I'm not going to say it again. I'm going to say Kate Bush again, Martin. But it had that Kate Bush feel about it. So, and then we came out of that. Marianne's going to go mad. And then we came straight out of that for Minimum, Small Hours. Can You Lift Me Up? Which was a lovely song again. And we'd like to hear more Minimums as well, if we possibly can. And then I'm never going to be able to pronounce this right. Eromnim. Got it that time. Eromnim 3 with DM6 Quantum. And I can't even remember the rest of the name. It was an amazing song, though, that beautiful piece of music, which is from their album Dark Machina. Then we had Etch a Sketch, The Wait, always great stuff from Rob. We then went into Caro C, Dreams for Alyssa. You're right, Phil, it wasn't a cowbell. You're absolutely right. You're always right on these things. I should never even try and attempt to be the right one on those. Then we went into Black Mass, Chernobyl. We won't do the joke again. Mark Oldbrow, Doors Slam, Water Splashes, Children Laugh, which I just, that was possibly my favourite song of the night. I don't know why. It was just something really nice about that. Eric Wallow, Different Spaces, we then moved into. And then we had Andy Pegg's Snorp Showcase, which is awesome. Go and have a look at Andy's Snorps on Bandcamp. And then we finished off with Big Black Delta, Hugging and Kissing, which was just a storming day. Dance tune. Martin, as always, you've done a superb job putting all the pieces together there and lining them all up and bookending it with some nice good banging beats in there. Phil, your insight from a person who, I don't know if we've mentioned it before, but was signed previously in the music industry as well, is always great to have in there, and great to have your insight into the stuff that's going on there. So have you enjoyed yourself, boys?
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah.
Well, there we go.
That's a stonking collection of frequencies.
It was indeed. Yeah. And also, of course, right in the middle, we had our interview with Dominic Halkin and that amazing piece of music that he let us play for him as well, which was superb. So we're very, very appreciative to Dominic for doing that for us as well. So I hope everybody's enjoyed the show. We'll be here again in a couple of weeks' time with some more special tunes. Martin, do you want to do your big goodbye first?
Bye.
That's an excellent one. It's better than last week. So, Phil.
There are bees, they say in Wolverhampton.
That's very good. Better than your theremin. Goodbye. We'll see you soon.
See ya. Bye.
Only
Human Radio.
Radio.